Some people prefer routine. Some others want, you know, to difference themselves by doing things differently. I'm trying to do things differently, but most of the time I'm failing.
No.
Let me give you an example. We went to Europe years ago. And when our way back, we have all of us, me, Carmen, and Ingrid, black suitcases. Black. And Dallas-Fort Worth is a huge airport, like O'Hare here. And we said, you know, when we are going to get our luggage back, everybody will be there, and we should spot our suitcases easier if we can tie a red ribbon around the handle. So I did that. Stickers are sticky. Red ribbon, it's okay. So we came back. There are 250 probably people waiting in line, you know. The carousel was going very slow, and all the suitcases were black, and 90% of them had the red ribbon. That's not how I would have done it. You know, I had a long talk with a friend, agnostic, regarding some of the stuff around, you know, a little bit about politics, bad. About health, bad, bad. About Christmas, not so bad, but you know, we spend time figuring out a better way to celebrate Jesus' birth. So it was not 25th December, because this is a pagan day, but when and how and why? You know, the why is important. My friend told me that one of the reasons he's still considering Christianity and the Bible is because the awkward story of a baby boy born in Bethlehem in a manger. Yes. What was God thinking when he planned the first coming of Jesus the way he did it? Now, figure out. A baby born to an unwed couple after a long, difficult journey, he's kind of too old for her, Joseph, while Mary was a teenager. The cradle is a feeding trough in a stable in Bethlehem, welcoming committee, shepherds, and some strangers coming from far away, uncircumcised, Gentile. A murderous king sent his soldier to slaughter the babies. The young family flees to a pagan Egypt. This is the background when Jesus entered the scene. I don't know about you, but I have to admit, I would not have done it this way. If you want, if you are a smart philosopher, and if you want to begin a new religion, you'll be careful with the beginning, you know, to people to believe you. Everything planned, everything okay. But look what happened with Christianity beginning. I'm talking about, you know, the New Testament and Jesus' story. Everything is awkward from my point of view. The red ribbon guy. Why this way? Being the creator of the universe, the infinite, the omnipotent Heavenly Father, God, you could be everything and everywhere. So, is not you that created the heavens and the earth? Okay. But right here, right now, in the Christmas story, why this way? Why then the poor Joe and Mary, shepherd, magi, some other strange characters, like this old guy Simeon and Anna, what they are doing there in the temple? Couldn't you do it any different? So the opening statement of scripture certainly establishes who is in charge. Who is in charge? In the beginning, God. So whose idea was this with Magi and Bethlehem and manger? Whose idea was this? God? Yes. That was in his plan of salvation. He planned to, he built that to be awkward. Stay tuned, because we have more good news. Is this awkwardness good news? Yes, it is. It is.
Checking to see if gravity was still working. Happy Sabbath. Can you hear me?
Yes.
This is an old African American spiritual, and this should break the ice a little bit. And it goes pretty fast, so here we go. Children, go where I send thee. Shall I send thee? I'm gonna send you from the forest, from the forest to the moon. You children, children, Paul and Silas, one was a little bitty baby born in Bethlehem. Children, go where I send thee. Gonna send you 6 for 6, cause 6 was a 6 that couldn't get fixed. 5 for the 5 that stayed out alive. 4 for the 4 that stood at the door. 4 for the 8 children, 2 for Paul and Silas, 4 for the baby born in Bethlehem. Children, go where I send thee. Gonna send you 8 by 8, cause it was 8 that stood at the gate. 7 for the 7, you go to the heavens. 6 for the 6, you put the gates. 5 for the 5, you stay out of line. 4 for the 4, you stay at the door. 4 for the 8, the children. 2 for the 1, and Silas. 1 for the baby born in Bethlehem. Children, go. I send thee. Oh, you gonna send me? I'm gonna send you 10 by 10, cause 10 for 10 they couldn't get in. 9 for the 9 you fell behind. 8 for the 8 you stood at the gate. 7 for the 7 you couldn't get in. 6 for the 6 you couldn't get in. 5 for the 5 you're now alive. 4 for the 4 you stood at the door. 8 for the 8 children, 2 for the 4 and
Amen. Turn the mic up.
Spoken word poetry piece. What good is the Christmas story if it's void of God and His glory? What's the worth of the words peace on earth if it's not rooted in the truth of Christ's birth? What benefit is it for us to discuss the joy of the season unless we fix our hearts and minds on the principal reason that Christ has atoned for us. See, Christmas is more than just a story of a baby born in a manger, more than a poor fiancé engaged to a humble virgin teenager, more than a magi, more than gold, frankincense, and myrrh. It's more than a narrative of a nativity scene. It was so much more that occurred. It's the coming of the Messiah, the fulfillment of old promises, the prophecy of the suffering servant, and all of his accomplishments. The second person of the Godhead commissioned to abandon his position and literally set aside the independent exercise of his attributes in full submission. The Word manifests in the flesh, the fullness of God expressed, the self-emptying Jesus poured out at the Father's request. The image of the invisible God, the radiance of the Father's fame, holy, but retained his humanness to empathize with our pain. He was unjustly crushed, chastised, cursed, and shamed, mocked and adored with a crown of thorns, disgraced. Displaced and faced with no room for a righteous Savior to be born soon, he slept sound a silent night. Shepherds safe, guarding sheep as angels seek the meek, they shout with might, say it with me, O holy night. All that he might fulfill the Father's will, the most monumental mark for mankind made in human history, behold the mystery, came to a wrecked, wretched world of sinners, to be made righteous by the wounds of the risen King, Holy Spirit dwelling for all men to be seen. The condescending of a holy God made in the likeness of men, a child born to the Savior that would save the world from their sins and bring it to an end. Perfect pairing for the daring to partake of the personal spirit he died to impart. Oh God, replace this heart of stone, to let it be known, the offspring of the virgin's womb, the Christ, God's only son, fully God, yet fully man, the only theanthropic one. This is what we celebrate, Christ the newborn king, a holy heavenly being veiled in flesh, the Godhead fully manifest for you to see. All hail incarnate deity.
Amen.
Let's talk for a minute about the place. Bethlehem. For us have romantic connotation, but at that time it was just a little village with poor people, shepherds. And the barn, the stable, where Jesus was born. Did you ever enter into a barn where animals are kept? Where animals are sleeping and eating and pooping in the same place? It's dirty, it's smelly, it's unhealthy, and there Jesus was born. Let me tell you something again. My child would not have been laid in a stable. Ingrid's birth, oh, the best room, the best gynecologist in town, the best nurses, everybody around her. And my child born in such dirty shack made for animals? No way. I will offer my child only the best of the hospital's rooms, the best of experienced nurses. But the Son of God, the living God, came into this world, and instead of Baptist Hospital, Loma Linda Hospital, what's the other one? The Methodist Hospital, maternity room. They put him in dirty hay with animals? Whose idea was this? Well, don't misinterpret what I'm saying here. I am certainly not criticizing God's plan. I just wonder, and I ask rhetorical questions. So the bottom line, had I would be God, I will never let my son in that humble and in sanitary places. You never see Hallmark cards like these ones. This is the modern, no romanticized version of nativity. This is how God chose to send His beloved Son, the only Son, in our world. It's not the way I would have done it, but He did. Stable. Dirty. Is not this world a huge stable with people? Sometimes they act like animals. Without God, yes. This is the place He chose to come and be born.
Look for it and couldn't find it. So I guess it wasn't meant to be. So this is an old one. I serve such a mighty God. He's everything to me. He gave me the greatest gift of all when He died on Calvary. Mm-hmm. He's such an awesome, loving God who created in His likeness all men. And all He ever asks of me is to go and tell the world of Him. He came as a babe into this world to show me how to live each day. He gave to me His holy book. He taught me how to pray. His presence is daily in my life. He always watches over me. He's there, though I may not know. He's kept me from life's tragedies. I know that it is to Him I can go whenever I'm feeling sad or blue. He gives me comfort and sweet peace. He's never let me down. He's always true. He promised He would come again to take me home above. He's been so ever patient, waiting for me to return His love. I know that He is coming soon, for of this world I am getting weary. I'm ready to go to my heavenly home and with loved ones again in the family. I want to thank the Lord for being there when of my life I've made a mess. And I want to personally greet my precious Savior and friend, Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
you compete with such talent?
Of course, I'm not competing here.
I was talking about shepherds as a welcoming committee. Why not scientists? You know, God sending angels to some super scientists, PhDs in understanding the world, and astrophysicians to Mr. Richard Dawkins. This is the leading expert in atheism. To shepherds. Who called them for this job? Why not some priests or Levites? Welcoming the Son of God. Imagine him descending on Air Force One. For the whole globe to see him with special guards around. But shepherds, you know, on a social scale, shepherds were just a notch above lepers. You don't associate with shepherds. They have no IQ. They have no idea about body hygiene. Nothing to talk with them. Shepherds. Shepherds were, and still, day laborers, or night laborers, in case of the ones being outside of Bethlehem. And you see them in the nativity scenes, you know, or in the movies. You see them, they're so nice and dressed in their long gowns with their shepherd's robes. And this is the romantic side, the cute side. In reality, we are talking about unskilled laborers, lowly paid, smelling bad, and probably despised. I doubt if they could read or write, and yet they were chosen by heaven to receive the birth announcement from the angel. Wow, this is not the way I do it. They were given front row seats as the audience for the Hallelujah chorus of angels. But these guys were not exactly musicians, and yet they attend the first open air concert given to mortals since creation. Why shepherds again? I'm asking again and again. How was that decision made up there in heaven? That's all I'm asking. Better qualified people, more righteousness people, more super saints around Bethlehem and Jerusalem. So think about next time when you read the Bethlehem story with the shepherds built in.
Check. Oh, there we go.
So I did variations on O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. So this is pretty much originally composed. Hope you like it.
Amen.
Wait a second here. Let me tune first.
Thank you.
somehow.
Sing along with us. 1:30. Came upon him. No, I'm sorry. Is it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was going to put Jesus Mounds on.
It came upon a midnight day, that glorious song of old. The wind was bending near the earth to touch the hearts of gold. Peace on earth and well to men, for heaven's a gracious king.
To see you again. This time I'm not gonna cry. I'll be singing "Oh Holy Night" by Selah.
Good song. Beautiful.
Oh, looks like Audrey's gonna join me up here.
She's okay. Couldn't catch her.
Where's your shoes? Okay. Stars are bright, they shine. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining. A thrill of
After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." Awkward. I mean, you go to Washington D.C. and you say, "Where is the after the elections? You know, where is the other president? Because we want to pledge allegiance to him." I would question God regarding the strangers coming far away to welcome Jesus, those magi. Did God really needed the magi during the birth of the Savior of this world? Looks to me like they just act as a filler here, just weird people looking suspicious, coming from the east. Kind of sorcerers, yeah? What do you do for a living? I am a magi. Are you kidding me? Are you reading stars and guessing the future? I will call the police, go away. And yet, they are there. They were given a prominent place in the birth of Jesus' story. The only thing I can figure out is that the gold they brought came in handy
to finance the sudden flight to Egypt.
Amen.
After that. Egypt? I have another problem with Egypt. I mean, where? Back there, the place Jewish people were in slavery? Was all of that long journey done just so some strangers could slip a little gold to Joseph and Mary? Couldn't it be arranged for Joseph and Mary to stumble on a treasure in a field somewhere, or win the lottery ticket? So. Well, that's enough, I suppose. We could question the story of Elizabeth and Zechariah from Luke chapter 1. We could question the story of the two elderly people coming to the temple, Simeon and Anna, and a few other things. So let me admit something here. Every single time I try to be smarty pants, I failed. Every time I question God's plan, I failed. I don't know about you, but I was wrong so many times. I was wrong when I built a mailbox out of blocks, huge, heavy, by myself, with no foundation. And when a little car bumped in, it was tumbled down. There was no way to put it back. So I left it there for months and months, almost a year, until somebody helped me to destroy it and carry it away. I was wrong when I bought my first car. I planned to be inexpensive, a nice good-looking one, and I ended up getting a junk, a lemon. Rust all over the place, 50 miles per gallon of oil. Back home, the mechanic told me, this is not how I would have done it. But it looks the way God fulfilled his plan exactly as is in the Bible, with magi, with stable, with shepherds, with everything awkward there. This is God's plan. And let me make the transition here. If I will choose a religion according to my earthly understanding, I'll never choose being Seventh-day Adventist. This is awkward. I mean, keeping this and keeping that and having this and Saturday and not Sunday like everybody else. And Sister White, what? However, God's plan is different than mine.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
And this is my appeal to you and to myself. You can say so many times, that's not, I would have done it, God. And he answers back, how about your life, Mr. Good Christian, Mrs. Good Seventh-day Adventist? That's not how I would have done it, not what I intended for you. How about your marriage? How about your family life? How about your church life? How about your struggle with temptation? How about struggling with judging people? How struggling with embracing or staying away of the roots of Seventh-day Adventists? How about this and how about that? Please, let God be God. Let God be the one providing the answer. Rasta, please, one more. This is the scripture that I would like for you to leave from this place. Because, yes, it's the caroling time. Everywhere I go, it's Christmas music. Few songs here, doesn't matter. Yes, matter a lot, because they are alive. And because this is worship, this is not entertainment. I am full until here with tam 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 ta da 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 da. I cannot stand.
So I have to shop online, except Aldi. They don't have music. Praise God. Do they? They don't have, no? No, no music. Good. I'm shopping from there. This is not entertainment. This is worship. It's meant to be worship. With music, with some poems. Thank you. But if we don't have this scripture in our mind, this understanding that God's way, it's different. Because He is here and I am here. Because He understands our needs to worship, to fellowship together, and go back to the Bethlehem story and see how much God sacrificed, leaving the splendors of heaven Amen. And coming here in dirt, having nothing, being despised and crucified. And the last point that I would like to ask you to consider is the second coming of Jesus. You see, everybody is focused on Jesus' first coming with everything we said here. But this is just the first plan of the rescuing plan, the first part of it. How many people still, really still longing for the second coming of Jesus? Look around. People are saying, two more months, and we're going to be done with this pandemic. And it will be a reset for the whole economy, for the whole world, a reset. We are going to have a better life. The super, super, super rich, maybe they will share their wealth and everybody will be better. We will solve the global warming problem. We will solve the pandemic. We will solve the poverty. We are in charge. And God saying, no.
No.
You are not in charge. I am in charge.
Mm-hmm.
And I have some people who really believe that I am in charge. I am coming back for them because I promise and He will be back. Can you believe that?
Mm-hmm.
Do you still believe?
Yes.
Do you still wonder about God's plan being sometimes awkward?
Mm.
I do. And it's okay to do that. Friends, I would not have done Jesus' story any different. Because I can see myself there. I can see being one of the shepherds. I can see myself being one of the magi, questioning, going, strange accent. You didn't hear me talking English when I came here. It was like dancing. Because I could not express a single word. And I think God, and that is a stretch for anybody's imagination. I would not have loved this pitiful race of humans and this pastor, Ovid, whatever his name, you know. Look at him. He deserved to be left here. But God is different. God is compassionate. God is inviting you to come into the narrative. The nativity scene and be part of that and praise Him for the plan of salvation.
Amen.
Can you do that?
Amen.
It's 141 if you want to follow in the hymnal.
Mm-hmm. Before I sing the final song here, I would like to give a little bit of recognition for Joseph here, Mr. Humble Man. He kind of put all this together.
Amen.
So, thank you, Joseph.
Thank you, Joseph.
The name of this song, and I just found out about this song, was it 2 weeks ago, Robert? 2 weeks ago, Robert texts me every once in a while. And he says, have you ever heard this song before? And the name of the song was, It Wasn't His Child. And before I responded back to him, I listened to it. I was like, it's a pretty cool song. So Joseph and I, it was practicing this last weekend, so It Wasn't His Child. So listen to the words, imagine yourself in Joseph's position. As he's giving birth, or as Mary is giving birth to his child.
He was her man, she was his wife, and late one winter night, he knelt by her. She gave birth, but it wasn't his child. It wasn't his child. Yet still he took him as his own, and yet he watched him grow. It brought him joy. He loved that boy. It wasn't his child. It wasn't his child. Unlike his father, he was strong and kind and good. And I believe he did his best. It wasn't easy for him, but he did all he could. He grew up with his hands in wood, and he died with his hands in wood. He was God's child. He was God's child. He was her man, she was his wife, and late one winter night, he knelt by her as she gave birth. But it wasn't his child, it was God's child.
The Lord is coming back.
Yes, he is. Amen.
The Lord is coming back.
Amen.
The same person who came here as a baby boy in Bethlehem, in hay, with animals and shepherds and strangers, is coming back. It's going to be a surprise for a lot of people again.
Yes.
I hope it's not going to be a surprise for you and I here.
No.
Because we know the plan. Was it awkward? Yes. And the second coming again, is this, I mean, everybody worshiping one day and the others persecution. Hey, you look at the eschatological way Seventh-day Adventists enter the Bible prophecies, and it looks like a little bit awkward. Please, study, pray, and believe God. Because God's plan is better than my plan in everything, including our life and our church life. Be ready. Give Him glory. By accepting Him today, you are going home, and again, music everywhere, and decorations, and jingle bell. You miss that.
You want me to sing that
for you? Yes, next time. And gifts and coziness of our homes. Please do not forget God's plan. Right here, right now. It's not just the improvement of a failed life. It's a new life in Christ.
Amen.
A new type of marriage, a new type of relationship, a new type of being sons and daughters and elders and deacons and teachers and preachers and students. In the birth of Jesus, we have the big reset possibility. It's open to us. Please, let's stand for the benediction. Lord, we are here to confess. We are narrow-minded, and yet we brag that we know about this and about that. Please, Lord, help us to be humble and accept by faith what for other people is awkward. Help us to accept You being in charge of our lives. And this is not a cliche. This is not an empty word said by a pastor because it's the end of the program. This is the desire of our heart, and this is the reality. Without You, Lord, we cannot do anything but foolish decisions, ending up nowhere. Please, Lord, help us to stay focused on Jesus Christ, be more like Him, and desire to be with Him forever. In Jesus we prayed. Amen.